Good morning. I take it you're applauding for the musicians and not for me. Welcome. My name is Stephen Sanders. I'm one of the pastors at Oak Hill. This morning, I, along with Reverend Ryan Jensen and our musicians led by Louise Avant, we are leading up front this morning. If you are worshiping with us online, we have an online host, Libby Gibbs, and our other pastor, Reverend Missy Jensen. And so I am so glad that you are here today. As we begin, I begin with an apology to people in our deaf community. Our usual interpreters are out of town, and it looks like the agency was not able to supply someone for today. And we tried to contact everyone in advance. And so I'm sorry for that, but that's kind of what life is in Austin right now, and we are doing our best. For those of you who are new with us at Oak Hill, whether this is your first Sunday or you've been coming for a little while, I am so glad that you have chosen to be here today, and I pray this time is a blessing. For those worshiping with us online, we invite and encourage you to fully participate in worship. If you would let us know that you are here and just drop your name into the chat line, and if you have joys or concerns that you would like to share, put those in there too, and one of our pastors will be getting those and sharing those with our prayer list. For those in the sanctuary, if you would look inside your bulletin, please, there is a little note card. And it has two things in it. It has a place for you to share joys or concerns with us. And if you would like to share those with the whole congregation, just write anything down there. And if you want to have that shared just with the pastors, mark that for the pastors only, and we will hold that in confidence. And if you'd also fill out the upper part of the card and let us know that you're here today. We are trying to stay in contact with people and follow up. And if you're gone, we want to be checking in on you. We're working on that. And so if you would do that, I would appreciate it. Also, over on the far side by the organ on your far left, we have an area called our playground. And this has become an important thing this summer as kids in the congregation have been able to participate fully in worship, but also get over and move. And so it's a place for kids to be able to quietly pray and play and be part of worship with their grown-ups and with the whole congregation. So grown-ups, the kids are still your responsibility, but congregation, they're our responsibility as a church because Jesus has called us to be loving on those kids. So that's what I have to share with you this morning as we come into this time. I invite you now, would you stand with me, please, as you are able? And will you join with me in calling ourselves into a time of worship? The words are on the screen. Will you join with me? God, you search me and know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. God, you search me and know me. You are familiar with all my ways. God, you search me and know me. You know my joy, my despair, my anger, my apathy. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. We gather to praise your holy name. I invite you to remain standing as you are able, and will you join and lift your voice to God in song as we sing For the Beauty on the Earth. Words are either on the screen or on page 92 in your hymnal. Let us lift our voices to God.
Oh, You may be seated. As we worship God this morning, let us open our hearts in prayer and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, there is not a thought that enters our minds or emotion that we feel that goes unnoticed by you. Every joy and celebration, every sadness, pain, frustration, or fear, you are present with us for all of who we are, and you love us even when we are less than perfect and put together. Help us to recognize the same value that you see in us, whether we are at our highest highs or our lowest lows. And when life weighs on us and we can't seem to figure out how to work our way out of whatever rut we find ourselves in, may your gentle presence reassure us that we are not alone, that all of life's challenges are merely temporary, and that your grace is sufficient to see us through them. Oh Lord, it is hot outside. And as the heat continues to make things all steamy and uncomfortable for everyone, we are grateful for the opportunities that we have available to us to escape from it. But for those who do not have access to the same, we pray that you would watch over them and keep them safe and cool. And as we head into these last couple of weeks of the summer break, and as we near the start of a new school year, we lift up teachers who are already readying their classrooms and making other preparations for the students who will be learning from them this year. Fill their tanks with all kinds of energy and excitement, with renewed passion and drive, and help them to be ready to love on all those who pass through their doors. And even though the students who are about to head their way may not be ready to let go of their summer break, we ask that you fill them with an eagerness to learn and explore more about this world of your creation. Lord God, this morning we lift up special prayers for those who are on our hearts. For Jennifer Barkas and her family on the loss of her mom. For Margaret Jones, Greg Trader, Pat Murphy, David Sheets, Jim Giroux, David and Davina, those on our prayer list, and for those unnamed, but whom we hold close all the same. Hear are our prayers, and may your grace be prevalent in their lives and in ours. We ask all of this with the words that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now I'd like to invite the kids forward for a special time this morning with Miss Carla.
Everybody? Oh, hey everybody. Okay, here comes Abe. All right. Come on down. Who's ready for school to start? Hey everybody, okay. Hey, can anybody ever think of a time when they've been sad? Can you even think of a time when you've been sad? Anybody? When have you been sad? Can you give me a specific time when you were sad? Okay. Anybody else? I want to tell you about a time when I was really sad. So when I was growing up, my granddad, who I called, because I'm from South Mississippi, my granddaddy, he was really, really special to me. I would go over to his house, and it was just always a party when we were over there. It didn't have to be somebody's birthday, but it was just so much fun. It was just a special occasion every time we went over. And when I was a senior in high school, he passed away pretty suddenly. And I was so, so sad because he was a really special person to me and he wasn't there anymore. So I had to go out of town and go to his funeral and his service. And the saddest part for me was being in his house without him there. That was really hard. I just missed him so much. So when I had to come back to school and kind of go back to normal life, that was really hard. But I remember when I walked into my health class, Coach Long, he was a old redneck coach who coached football and who knows what else, and he was friends with my dad. And without saying anything at all, he just gave me a really big hug. And it made me feel better. It made me feel like I kind of wasn't alone in what I was going through. And I want you to know that it's okay to be sad. It's okay to be sad when little silly things happen, like maybe there aren't enough peppermints out on the in the narthex, we missed out. But I've never experienced that because they are really good about keeping that filled. Or if something more serious happens, like you're left out at school or somebody's mean to you, it's okay to be sad. And I think it's really important to have somebody that you can talk to about it, whether it's a parent or a friend or a friend's parent. It's really important so that you're not by yourself in it. And I think the most important thing to remember is that God can make anything good. Even if it seems like it's such a bad, hard situation, and it seems like it'll never get better, you'll never be happy again, God can surprise you with making it good again. Okay? Will you guys pray with me? Dear God, when I'm sad, help me to remember that you're with me. Help me to remember I'm loved by you. Help me to remind others you love them too. Amen. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Cole Castaneda, and I'm the technical director here at Oak Hill, and I'm the head of the tech team. The tech team are the wonderful people over by that table over there, and we're in charge of producing the sermons. And whether that's our slideshow operator, or our soundboard operator, our video camera operator, or our Facebook monitors, we're not only here to run the stream at 11, but we're here to make sure every worship is a wonderful time to enjoy service. I'm really grateful for this opportunity to have a ministry celebration because I want to share with everyone the opportunities on the tech team. We're looking for volunteers of any skill level, whether you are a photography hobbyist or you're a musician or you're just a really good listener. We have positions available for pretty much anyone. I'm looking to hopefully expand the number of volunteers. Currently, we have about 5 people who've been doing a fantastic job of showing up on Sundays, but I'd like to be able to give them an opportunity to enjoy service from the pews or take a Sunday off. So if you're interested, we have a QR code that you can scan, or if you don't want to deal with it, let me know. I'm over by that tech table, and I'd be more than happy to help you get involved. And if you're nervous about it may not be for you, talk to me. I think you'd be surprised what is available. I have prepared a short video. Oh, and that slide will be running in the narthex after service as well. But I have a short video prepared for you, and I hope you'll enjoy. Thank you.
And I've been with Oak Hill United Methodist since the middle of the 90s. And I've been glad that I'm here. I've been working on the sound system or the audio visual group for a number of times. We went from a very minimal group, minimal service setup, to a larger one, to a very newer one, which is really, really good and easy to use. Cole's done a great job in setting things up, and working it is a charm. At first, it was hard to follow the sermon, because you're always worried about the sound being correct and that there's a lot of nuances. But now that I've worked the board for quite a while, I get a lot out of the sermon. I get to check things out, and it's helped me grow. I've met new people working the other aspects, the video, the actual streaming, and the images that we place on the wall, and you get to know those people, and it's really been interesting. I think learning all the new things on the sound system itself, and just being able to come in and work it so easy. It looks complicated, but it's really easy to do. I never thought it would be as quite as easy as it is, and it's just a few buttons here and there that you push after you get it all started up, and you're set to go.
Hello, I'm Ann Morse. I am part of the tech team here at Oak Hill. I typically do Pro Presenter, which puts the words on the screen, and sometimes I do ATEM. I've been a member of Oak Hill a year and a half, maybe getting close to 2 years. I joined during pandemic because I was watching Oak Hill online. So that's how I found it. And then I was looking for ways to volunteer. And one of the ministry celebrations during that time was to join the tech team. It helps me be part of this church instead of just coming and experiencing the worship service in Sunday school. It helps me be part of the service for other people who can't physically come be here. I get a preview. I get a preview of what the pictures and the sermon is going to be. I also volunteer in the church office, so Thursday afternoons I stuff the bulletins with the attendance cards or if there's any other special items that we're going to put in the bulletin. So I get a preview of the bulletin, and then when I get here on Sundays, I get a preview of the worship service, and it also introduced me to more people in the church. So that's why those are my favorite things about being part of the tech team and being a member here at Oak Hill.
All right. Well, whether it's helping to be able to hear our speakers in the choir or to be able to see the words to the hymns as we sing or making our service available to those joining us remotely online, our tech team fills an important role and serves in a ministry that we all benefit from. So we are grateful to them and for the ways in which God has equipped them to serve. As we respond to God's incredible love and goodness that is being worked in our lives and through this church, I want to invite you to make an offering back to God at this point. And we can do that in a few different ways. Our ushers are coming forward with offering baskets. And as those are passed, you can drop an offering in one of those. And as you do, you can also place your attendance card in there as well. You can text the number on the screen, or you can give online through the giving page on our website. All right, well, let us pray and bless these gifts that we bring. Holy God, the works of your hands are good and abundant. Your blessings number more than we can count. Your faithfulness is beyond measure. Receive these gifts that we bring to you today as a sign of our thanks and as an act of trust in your unfailing love. May your cup of blessing continue to overflow on all who receive them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Traveler's on the journey, fellow pilgrims on the road. sister, let me be your servant. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too.
And this morning we have Aiden Manier here to read our scripture.
Hi.
You can go.
As we get ready to hear our scripture reading this morning, I would like to invite you into a word of prayer. Let us pray. Draw us close, Holy Spirit, as scriptures are read and the word is proclaimed. May we carry them on our lips and in our hearts. Let the word of faith transform us and animate our daily living. Amen.
Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Lamentations chapter 1, verse 1 through 6. It reads, "How lonely sits the city that once was full of people. How like a widow she has become, she that was great among the nations, she that was a princess among the provinces, has become subject to forced labor. She weeps bitterly in the night, with tears on her cheeks among all her lovers. She has no one to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone to exile with suffering and hard servitude. She lives now among the nations. She finds no resting place. Her pursuers have all overtaken her. In the midst of her distress, the roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the festivals. All her gates are desolate. Her priest groan. Her young girls grieve, and her lot is bitter. Her foes have become the masters. Her enemies prosper. Because the Lord has made her suffer for the multiple of her transgression. Her children have gone away captive before the foe. From daughter Zion has departed all her majesty. Her princesses have become like stags that find no pasture. They fled without strength before the pursuer. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be God to God. I'm sorry, this is squeaky.
Aiden, you did a great job, okay? And Aiden, it's my job to make people sleepy. You didn't cause a problem, okay? Will you join with me in a moment of prayer? Gracious and eternal God, we pray that you open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit. Take our hands and use them. Take our lips and move them. And take our hearts and set them afire with your unending love. Through Christ's most holy name we pray. Amen. This summer, we've had a worship series entitled Faith Animated. Each week, we have looked at a different animated movie and reflected upon what it teaches us about core proclamations of the Christian faith. Last week, Pastor Missy reflected on Finding Nemo, which reminds us, just keep swimming. Surround yourself with the loving, supportive community that can help you keep living faithfully even when it's not easy. Encanto reminds us that God has gifted each of us with talents and abilities, but those are absolutely worthless unless they are not used in love. Our final Sunday in this series is on the movie Inside Out. I'm just curious, how many of y'all have seen Inside Out? 50-50. So for those of you unfamiliar with Inside Out, it tells the story of an 11-year-old girl by the name of Riley. And it tells the story, her story, from two perspectives. It tells us what is going on outside in Riley's world around her. And it also shows us something on the inside. We get to see five different characters that represent five of her different emotions. Take a look at the opening scene and see how just what's going on and just pay attention to the different emotions that come out in Riley's life. It begins with her birth.
Due to federal copyright law, we're unable to show these video clips to you online. So I'm just going to share what happens in the movie. The opening scene begins with Riley as a little baby girl. And she looks up and she sees the faces of her parents staring down at her. And Riley coos with gladness. Then we get to see her emotions going on inside. They're depicted as characters who stand in front of a control panel and communicate their emotions outward. The first one that we meet is joy. When Riley's parents say how wonderful and precious their daughter is, Joy pushes a button on the control panel, and Riley's face smiles with gladness. Every time something wonderful happens, Joy communicates to Riley about how wonderful this is, and Riley is happy and filled with life. Then we get to meet other characters along the way. We meet the character of Fear. Fear is depicted as a man who is just paranoid, and Fear's job is to keep Riley alive, to keep her safe. So when Riley is running around the house and she approaches an electric cord, Fear throws on the brakes, and Riley comes to a stop and safely steps over an electric cord. Then we meet Disgust. Disgust, her job is to keep Riley from getting poisoned to death, or even worse, embarrassed. And so when Riley is being fed broccoli, Disgust takes over the control panel and keeps Riley from poisoning herself by eating broccoli. When their father says that unless she eats her meal, she won't get dessert, anger shows up. Anger believes that it is his job to make everything fair. When something is wrong, he explodes in anger, and anger causes Riley to explode at her father. Finally, we meet sadness. Sadness is depicted as a blue, melancholy character. And quite frankly, Joy is not sure what to do with sadness.
So we get to see five of Riley's emotions on the inside. And Inside Out reminds me of something about who we are as human beings. We call our species Homo sapiens, which means wise or thinking ones. We human beings have the ability to think. We have logical brains, and we can deduce facts and make informed decisions. We are thinking beings. Yet, my friends, we are also emotional beings. We all have emotions within our own lives. Psychologist, and I would call her a theologian, Brené Brown, in her book Atlas of the Heart, identifies 87 distinct human emotions. And she says that the average human being can identify three: happy, sad, and angry. We are emotional and thinking beings. One of the things, though, that happens with many of us, is we sometimes will try to avoid or ignore certain emotions that we're experiencing. That's what happens with Riley. At the ripe old age of 11, her dad gets a new job, and the family has to relocate from their bucolic life in Minnesota to a new life in San Francisco. And there, Riley has to go to her first day of school. In this next clip, I invite you to look what's happening both on the outside and on the inside with Riley's emotions at her first day at a new school.
In this scene, Riley heads off to school for her first day in a new school. She stands at the door about ready to leave the house, and her mom asks, "Do you want us to go with you?" And Joy takes the control panel inside, and Riley smiles and says, "No, I can go by myself." So Riley heads out the door, and she goes to school. Inside of Riley, Joy has found the character Sadness and drawn a circle on the ground and told Sadness that her job today is to stay inside that circle. Stay inside the circle of Sadness. Joy does not want Sadness coming out today. So Riley makes it to school, and she goes and she sits down in her new classroom and sees the students around her. At the control panel, fear comes out with all the possibilities of what could go wrong today and says the worst thing that could possibly happen was having to introduce herself to all the class. And that is exactly what the teacher asked her to do. The teacher asked Riley to introduce her to the entire class. Initially, fear tries to take over, but Joy comes to the control panel. And Joy tries to make everything sound wonderful. Riley starts off well. She shares about how much that she came from Minnesota and how much she loved her life there, that she played on a hockey team and it was really cold there, and she would go and skate on the lake with her parents, that everyone in her family were wonderful at skating. But then something begins to happen. Sadness has come out from her circle. And sadness somehow is touching the memories that Riley is sharing about. And Riley begins to get quiet and almost start to cry. And then somehow sadness makes her way to the control panel. And sadness takes over and begins to share the emotion of sadness with Riley. And Riley breaks into tears. And Joy doesn't know what to do. All Joy knows to do is to try to get sadness away and not let sadness communicate anything to Riley.
Seven-year-old Riley tries to ignore her sadness and pretend like it's not there. Now, I have never been an 11-year-old girl, so I cannot speak to Riley's experience. But I can tell you that as a guy, one of the things that I learned from the air that I breathed in my culture growing up is there are certain emotions that you not only don't share, but it's best not even to go there. I don't know if you've ever had this experience. Have you ever had a horrible, terrible, no good, very bad day? And someone comes and asks you, how are you doing today? It's one of those days where you just want to climb in the hole. And what do I say? Pretty good, yourself? Anybody ever done that? As a pastor, I have often heard people express the assumption that they shouldn't have feelings that they have. I don't know how many times someone has sat down and shared with me, I know I shouldn't feel this way, but. And sometimes we even give that idea religious credence. After all, the Bible says, make a joyful noise to the Lord. And we may tell ourselves when we don't feel joyful that there may be something wrong with us, and maybe our faith isn't as strong as it should be. Yet, my friends, the Christian faith never, ever tells us to ignore what it is that we are feeling inside. Jesus is our example. And think about Jesus' life. Remember when Jesus' friend Lazarus died? And Jesus went to be with Lazarus' sisters, and Jesus went to the grave, and Jesus was so sad that Jesus wept. On Jesus' last night, he was overcome with fear, and he prayed to God, God, let this cup pass from me. Our emotions are not something we are called to avoid. They are, in fact, my friends, a good gift from God. Turn to the first page of your Bible, the first page in Genesis. In Genesis, it says that in the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, and then God said, let us make humankind in our image. So God made humankind in God's image. In the image of God, God created them. Male and female, God created them. God created human beings and looked at them, and God said, it is... No! God said, it is very good. My friends, God did not make junk. God gave us brains that we can think logically. God also gave us our feelings and our emotions. And when we are willing to value those can be good gifts from God. The book of Lamentations recognizes that. Aiden, you did a great job reading from Lamentations. It is not easy. For those of you unfamiliar with Lamentations, it is a tiny little book consisting of six poems sandwiched between Jeremiah and Ezekiel. And each of those six poems is written in an acrostic. Now, if you don't know what an acrostic is, a first grader in the worship service at 8:30 told the entire congregation, so don't feel bad or anything. But her parents didn't know she knew that. An acrostic is something that is written in what we would call A to Z. And each of those six poems in Lamentations is written in what we would call A to Z in the Hebrew alphabet. And it simply goes through and names the troubles that the people are experiencing. A, our nation has become like a widow. B, she weeps bitterly in the night. Lamentations was probably written after the destruction of Jerusalem in 587 BC. In that year, the Babylonian Empire conquered the nation of Judah and decimated their capital city. And the people's lives were just tossed into turmoil. And folks' hearts were broken. And by writing each of the six poems in Lamentations as an acrostic, they became a prayer that the people could memorize and pray together as a congregation. And so that you just run down through the alphabet. C, our nation has gone into exile. D, the roads mourn. E, our foes have become our master. Spiritually, Lamentations gives permission not only to pay attention to our emotions, but to recognize them and lift them up before God. Now, paying attention to our emotions is not the same thing as letting them control us, okay? There's a difference between honoring our emotions and letting them control us. Riley lets her emotions control her. She gives in to her anger and despair about having to move, and she steals money from her mother and and boards a bus heading back to Minnesota. She wants simply to run away. When her mother calls trying to find her, Riley hangs up and won't listen to her mother, and her emotions control her. My friends, that's not healthy. In his letter to the Ephesians, the Apostle Paul writes, "Be angry, but do not sin." You see, it is not healthy for us when we let our emotions control us, because when they do, we often end up hurting ourselves or people around us who are dear to us. Brené Brown writes that when we deny and disengage from tough emotions, they don't go away. Instead, she said, they own us. They define us. Yet when we are willing to pay attention to our emotions, they tell us what we need to know. They remind us of what is important to us. They motivate us in how to live. Last week, a family from the church invited Mary and me, my wife and I, to go over. Wife and me. Anyway, my mom was an English teacher. That's a hard one on me. A family from the church invited my wife and me to go over to their house for dinner. And when your mom's an English teacher, some things are just hard, okay? And we went over to a family's house for dinner, and we sat around the table, and we got to to visit and laugh and share with them. And then we sat in the living room and we visited as they played with their kids. And on the drive home, I thought about the evening that I just had. And I paid attention to my emotions. And do you know what I experienced, what I felt? I felt joy. I just felt alive after spending an evening with another family from this church. I just felt alive inside. And my joy reminded me that I need other people. After this long, crazy season, I need to be connected with other people. And when I listened to my joy, it told me, do more of that. But then about 2 months ago, there was the massacre in Uvalde. And when I heard about that, I wanted to be angry. But when I paid attention to my emotions, I did not feel the least bit angry. You know what I felt? I felt numb. I have become so accustomed to this carnage that I was numb to it. And when I paid attention to my numbness, it motivated me. And I called my state representative and I sat down with her and we had a cup of coffee together and I asked her, how can I help? I'm a pastor and I'm a gun owner. How can I help? You see, my friends, if we will pay attention to our feelings, to our emotions, if we will let them speak to us, they will remind us of how to live. You see, God has given us both brains and God has given us hearts. And part of the spiritual life, part of the Christian spiritual life, involves learning to listen to both. It involves learning to listen deep down inside. And that is often where God will speak in our lives. Riley finally begins to pay attention to her sadness. Instead of trying to keep her sadness tightly wrapped in a circle, Riley begins to let her sadness speak. She gets off the bus, and she runs back home, and watch what happens when Riley allows her sadness to speak.
In this final scene, Riley comes back home. She has gotten off of the bus as she tried to flee, and she goes back home and comes in the door. Her parents are elated to see her. But in this scene, instead of joy taking the control panel, joy allows sadness to take control and to help Riley share what's going on within her. Riley stands in front of her parents and she begins to cry. She says, I miss Minnesota. I miss my home. I just want to go home. I miss my friends. I miss skating. I miss playing hockey. And sadness allows Riley to share what's going on in her life. And Riley begs of her parents, please don't be mad at me. Please don't be mad. And then something happens with her parents. Their sadness begins to speak too. They begin to admit that they miss Minnesota. They miss the places where they used to go hiking and where they used to go ice skating. And Riley, as she hears her parents share their own sadness, and she is able to express her own sadness, something happens within this 11-year-old girl. And her parents draw her near and wrap her in the arms of embrace. And we can see Riley take a great big breath of freedom as she is wrapped in the embrace of her parents. She allows her sadness to speak, and it begins to allow her to feel that she is embraced by those who love her.
My friends, our feelings, our emotions are a good gift from God. Part of the Christian spiritual life involves learning to pay attention to them. When we learn to pay attention to them, they will tell us what we need to know. They will remind us how to live, and they will motivate us from action, for action. When you experience joy in your life, recognize it and thank God and praise the Lord. When you experience anger, listen to it. It will remind you of what value has been trampled, and it will motivate you for action. And when you experience sadness, be willing to feel it. Be willing to recognize it in your life. And that trust that as Riley was embraced in the arms of her loving parents, you will be embraced in the arms of the God who loves you at the core of your being. Just as the old song says, you can lean into God's everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Amen. Y'all sounded good there. Before we move into our final song this morning, I want to give you an invitation. Here's my invitation to you this week. It's a spiritual practice. Sometime this week, at the end of the day, just take a moment and sit down and recognize what you've experienced that day. Maybe ask yourself sometime this week, when did I feel most alive today? Just ask yourself that question. Or ask yourself the flip side of that question. When did I feel most drained today? Just practice paying attention inside. That is a way that God will move and stir within your life and motivate you to live boldly and faithfully in this world. If you're at a point today where you are ready to affirm or reaffirm your own relationship with God in Christ, I invite you to do that. You can do that where you stand as we sing our final song. And if you're ready to become part of the life of Oak Hill, if you're worshiping with us online, if you would visit with Pastor Missy online, and if you're in the sanctuary, I invite you either to come forward as we sing our final song and visit with Pastor Ryan or me, or meet any of the pastors either out in the foyer area or out in the courtyard. But will you stand with me as you are able? And we're going to do this song at a little different pace than we just sang it. But I invite you to join with one another and lift your voices to God as we trust that we can lean into God's everlasting arms no matter what. Let us lift our voices to God.
Jesus, please.
before Pastor Ryan sends us out with a blessing, I want to let you know about one thing that's going on with staff in the life of Oak Hill. Ryan shared during prayer time that Jennifer Barkus's mom died on Thursday, and so I ask that you lift Jennifer and her entire family in prayer. And also that Jennifer has requested a change in her responsibilities at Oak Hill. For a long time, she has been director of the preschool. And just before COVID started, she also took on the responsibility for children's ministries for the whole church. And that worked for the season, but Jennifer has realized it's not going to work going forward. And so she has asked a group in the church called the SPRC, Staff Parish Relations Committee, which is our human relations group, to take that responsibility off of her plate. And so we're going to begin looking for someone to lead the children's ministry parts. Jennifer is going to remain director of the preschool, but as we work to rebuild after this crazy season of life, we're going to begin looking for someone who can help take this ministry forward and be rebuilding after a difficult season. So I ask that you keep Jennifer in your prayers at the death of her mom, and also as she begins this transition, and for the church as we begin looking for the person to take that role. Ryan.
All right, as we get ready to head out today, we have a couple connections opportunities that we'd like to let you know about. As I'm sure you can guess, or maybe you know, it's no fun to be hungry and to wonder where your next meal is coming from. So we want your help to fill some empty stomachs. Our next meal for the Esperanza community is coming up on Friday, August 12th, and we need volunteers to help cook and to serve. If you can help out with this important ministry, please stop by the connection station as you leave. For more information. And youth, are you ready for a whole night of fun? Who needs sleep when there's playing to do, right? Well, join us this Friday at 6 o'clock for a lockout / lock-in. We'll be heading over to the Union Underground for some globe bowling and then over to Amy's Ice Cream for a sweet treat before making our way back to the church for a full night of awesomeness. All right. Well, now as we leave this place, know that the presence of God goes with us. Know that God is big enough to handle all of our emotions, and even when they aren't pretty, God is going to love us anyway. God's going to love us through our highs and our lows, our joys and our grief. Nothing is going to push God away. So let's learn to love ourselves too and show ourselves some grace. Go in peace. Amen.